Hey, what's up, guys? Arava here, and welcome back to the episode of my F1 2020 My Team Career Mode, episode number 82 today for the finale of season 4 of this career mode. We've got a championship decider between Lando Norris and Carlos Sainz. If you guys did miss the previous episode at the Mexican Grand Prix, then be sure to go check that one out before you see this one. That set up this finale, essentially, and it was a very dramatic episode. A big moment occurred about two-thirds of the way through that Grand Prix, Carlos Sainz retiring from the Mexican Grand Prix. So it means going into this one, Lando Norris does have quite a hefty advantage of 18 points over his, well, in real life current teammate, but obviously in the game, we signed Sainz in season 2 and then he returned to the Red Bull family as it was in season 3. But this year, he's been way more consistent. He's actually won way more races than Lando Norris, but he's been way more consistent, I think. You can see over the course of the season, Norris has kind of stayed within the realms of the top five a lot of the time. He's got less wins. Sainz had that mega run from Austria to the Belgium Grand Prix. But of course, Red Bull have still been somewhat unreliable and unlucky with their race strategies. Well, not unlucky, kind of just a little bit stupid at times with their race strategies. And so it's meant Sainz had a few stinkers of races and he's had a few, obviously, DNFs as well. He started off the season with a DNF. But here he is then with a chance to still mathematically win the championship. But the deck is very much stacked against him, but it's Sao Paulo, the Brazilian Grand Prix. As a finale, this race always chucks up some craziness, so you can just never tell what's going to go on. For us, personally, and for the team here at Arava Archer Racing, we're hoping just for a very strong finish. The car is clearly getting better and better. We come to this Grand Prix with further upgrades just to finish off the season, and then we're looking to end it off strong, basically, to carry some momentum into the winter, into season 5, which I hope is going to be a return to a championship fight, not only for the team, but myself. You would say Pierre Gasly as well, if we retain him for next season, because he's been mega in this second half, you know, obviously getting multiple pole positions as of late. So it's going to be a very interesting finale. A lot of loose ends to tie up as well for other teams. You know, you've got that battle between Mercedes and Renault. How are Ferrari going to do? They've been really improving quite a fair bit in the last few races, so we will see them finally return to kind of some form. And then you've got a bit of a span of the works in the form of AlphaTauri, the second Red Bull team. They're just quick and just there, so they're going to just be annoying, I think, the kind of top guys, and annoying Lando Norris and Carlos Sainz potentially. And so with that, we're well into the race weekend, then through into Q2. Q1 was a pretty straightforward affair, but Gasly looking quick again, topping the timesheets in that first part of qualifying, so he really is becoming Mr. Saturday Man. Although he may not have the race pace completely down, maybe that's something he could develop next season, which I'm kind of worried about, to be honest. I'm kind of worried about what kind of Pierre Gasly we could see next year if this car is fully ready to take on the top guys, Red Bull, McLaren, Ferrari, what have you, consistently over the course of the season. Obviously, not starting bankrupt like we did at the beginning of this one. But into Q2, and we do the business. This time, a little bit more closely matched. Leclerc showing some good pace in Q2, but we're both through into Q3. And the important thing here is, once again, Sainz and Norris are the only two men who've gone differently on race strategy, and they've qualified in this session on the medium tyres. So they will be starting the race on mediums, whereas everyone else will be starting on these soft compound tyres. The tyre wear is quite low now, obviously, with the upgrades every single team's done. So I suspect it still might be a one-stop for most people. It'd just be a case of maybe Sainz and Norris may feel more comfortable as we get to around, I would say, lap 10, when the tyre wear starts to kick in for those soft compound tyres. But I don't know what it is with the coding of this game. I don't know if it, on purpose, always has the championship contenders going differently and doing the kind of alternative strategy, because no one else has done this. I definitely couldn't have, I wasn't confident of pulling it off. But in previous seasons, we've also seen that the championship contenders have always gone to the medium tyre in the last few episodes of the season. I don't know if that's actually a deliberate thing to kind of, you know, separate them from everyone else, but obviously those two are kind of covering each other off then. But obviously Sainz has to, you know, do some miracle work here, really, if he wants to try and win this championship and get it away from the kind of lead that Norris has at the moment. But we go into Q3 then. The sun is coming down. It's now time to do the business. This is where it matters for the final racing grid. grid at the moment. Leclerc goes top, but obviously we're at the very beginning of the session. I do have two sets of soft tyres here, so I do have two runs, thankfully, unlike the last few episodes. So I can actually have two goes at this and try and improve on my first lap time, which is only good enough for P4 at the moment. But we're ahead of the two AlphaTauris as it stands, but then Giovinazzi goes quicker than us. And at the moment, Sainz is on provisional pole, Norris down in P4, our teammate Gasly in P3. So interesting spread there. So Sainz doing the best job he can and getting the max position he can, but Norris doing a decent enough job to kind of, you know, do as well as he can in P4 there. The McLaren, I suspect, is going to be a little bit slower around this circuit than the Red Bull cars, because I think generally the Red Bulls this season, they've definitely suited the tracks with higher downforce, kind of more need on the chassis and the aero, whereas the McLarens clearly have been all about kind of straight line speed along with the AlphaTauris. But let's see how it goes on for this second flyer. For us, we've gained about 3/10 here, so a decent amount of time. Sainz goes even quicker on that pole lap. We go better, but it's only good enough for P5. Still behind our teammate Pierre Gasly, and Norris goes even better to P3. But by the end of the session, Sainz does indeed get pole position for tomorrow's Grand Prix. Gasly improved to P2 on his second run, so a really good lap from him. Leclerc in a very high P3 in the Ferrari, I must say, especially compared to his teammate Giovinazzi, way down in P10. To be fair, there's a lot of disparity between teammates here in this session. You've got Sainz down to Ricciardo, Leclerc to Giovinazzi. I guess myself and Gasly kind of almost the smallest gap, I guess, along with the AlphaTauris of Perez to Verstappen, but even Norris to Ocon is quite a sizable gap there. But you can see the McLaren's clearly struggling a little bit, but Lando Norris is still there. You know, P5, if he was to finish in P5 in the race, that's good enough for him to seal the title no matter what Sainz does. So that's why I feel like the deck is very, very much skewed in the Brits' favour. A little bit disappointed to be that down the order compared to Gasly position-wise. Time-wise, we are actually not that far off him. It's probably been the closest we've been to him time-wise, but it's because the grid is so close in that top 10. So we've got some work to do. It's going to be a one-stop, I think. So it'll be quite hard to do anything interesting on strategy, but race pace was a lot better for us at Mexico. So let's hope for more of the same here today. Let's go. What a final race of season 4.
Formula One returns to Sao Paulo once again with the stage set for what promises to be another classic Brazilian Grand Prix. Sebastian Vettel famously clinched his third championship here in 2012. And in 2016, Max Verstappen treated us to one of the finest wet weather drives of all time. It's an unusual anti-clockwise race here at Interlagos, where the Sao Paulo locals are packed into the grandstands at each of the 15 corners around this classic 2.7-mile circuit. Two very fast sections bookend the famous and highly technical Sector 2, where getting a good run out of Junsao into one of the two DRS zones will be the key to any overtaking prospects today. And so, for one final time this season, Anthony Davidson joins me in the commentary box.
Well, the winter break is looming once again. No doubt many of those teams already have their eyes firmly on next season. But there's still work to be done here, still championship positions to decide, which can make a big difference to the prize money. So no one's going to be taking their foot off the throttle just yet.
Before we begin, let's take a quick look at the grid lineup for today's race. Pierre Gasly lines up on pole position, and it's Charles Leclerc in P2. As we continue through the rest of the grid today, we have Perez, Norris, Max Verstappen, and the owner driver. Ricciardo, Ocon, Hamilton, and Carlos Sainz. Kvyat, Matsushita, Valtteri Bottas, and Albon. Stroll, Latifi, George Russell, and Nick De Vries. Schumacher, Giovinazzi, Magnussen, and Jack Aitken. It's almost time for those five red lights to go out. Then let's see who can prevail today.
You cannot make this stuff up. You really can't. Red Bull seem to be some of the unluckiest guys in this career mode save Vars when it comes to being in championship fights and being so inconsistent in the most crucial race of this season, where he needs to win to even have any sort of chance of winning the championship. Sainz is knocked off pole position by 10 positions, and he is down and starting this race in P10. Giovinazzi had a further grid penalty, so the Italian is in last place. That's why Sainz is in slot number 10 rather than 11. But it means Gasly, funny enough, once again inherits pole position on the grid. But Sainz is now six positions back from his championship rival, the rival which he is 18 points behind in the the standings. So it's going to be very difficult. He needs to make his way through and then hope Norris gets caught up in traffic or something. But we've seen so many times this season, Sainz has been kind of like a yo-yo. He's either dominating races and has such great pace, or he's just been nowhere and getting caught up in traffic. Maybe due to obviously having issues with his car a la last race. But it's not looking great for him. For us, it means we have one free position, obviously already on the grid. Our teammate is on pole, so it could be another strong race. And to be honest, ideally, I want to try and aim for a double podium. It's going to be tough because Sao Paulo is not my best circuit, to be honest, in terms of pace, especially turns one and two. I'm always so bad off that in sector one. But let's see. Let's go for it. Our car seemed to have kind of gotten better a little bit in the race last episode. So if we can end off with a double podium, that would be a really great way to end the season on a high and have that into the next one. But eyes on Norris and eyes on Sainz behind. It's going to be an interesting one. I don't know if it's going to be as tense as maybe we thought it would all season long. But no matter what, it is a championship decider today, and a brand new F1 world champion will be crowned either way. So let's get into this then. The final race of season four as we go to 5 red lights to the Brazilian Grand Prix, and we are underway. The lights on for an Asian Norris. Very slow off the line. He's on medium tyres, remember. So straight away, we use the advantage of the softer compound attire, and we're able to jump him and Max Verstappen. It's a really great getaway for us up into P4. Gasly maintains P1 ahead of Leclerc and Sergio Perez. And as we go down this straight, then I think it's Daniel Ricciardo looking to make a move on Lando Norris. Ocon side by side with Carlos Sainz. So the two McLarens and two Red Bulls have battle, and it's a copycat move there for Ricciardo and Sainz as Sainz goes around the outside as he watches Ricciardo do the same ahead of him. So it's now a checkerboard of Red Bull, McLaren, and Sainz is now directly behind his championship rival Lando Norris. Very nice to see, but really he's going to have to look to pass his rival and then get a move on, because he needs to get up into the top two positions at least to give him any kind of shot at this championship win. But it's maybe going to be tough. He's also on the medium tyres, but it looks like Norris just didn't fire up his tyres, like the tyre temperatures weren't there. We've seen that in real life, if you remember the Portuguese Grand Prix, where the tyres just weren't lit up at the start of the race, and so people were struggling. That's exactly what happened to Norris off the 5 red lights. Meanwhile, for us, our tyres feeling very, very decent, and we go for the move on the right-hand side. Round the outside we go at turn one, and Sergio Perez, the AlphaTauri, defends quite harshly, but we get it to the inside, and we're up into P3. Meanwhile, back behind, look at that, Sainz round the outside of Lando Norris, the two championship rivals now, side by side, and that is a crucial move for Sainz. Ocon gets in the middle of it. Ocon sends it down the inside of his teammate, and Norris is struggling. He's really not liking these medium tyres, and Ocon's passed. I'm surprised there's been no team orders from the McLarens there. Ocon just sent it, and that could have ended in calamity. You never know. There could be contact, whatnot. Ricciardo's in early. I don't know if he's been in the wars with the AlphaTauris, potentially, as Sainz now has overtaken both AlphaTauris now. In the next two laps, we've blinked, and the Spaniard, all of a sudden, is up into P4 of this Grand Prix. He's overtaken both AlphaTauris. Ricciardo's pit early for some reason. I maybe think he had some damage, maybe battling the two AlphaTauris, because those are the two cars he was obviously going to overtake next, along with Sainz. Sainz has done that, so maybe those guys tripped over one another, and that's the way Sainz slipped through into P4 so easily. And maybe just like this, because the two AlphaTauris are now fighting so hard on the following lap there, and you can see behind Ocon getting trapped, and Norris as well. Norris needs to clear these three, ideally, because, yes, okay, Sainz in P4, that's still fine, but if I was in his shoes, I'd want to try and clear these cars and just give myself a bit of a cushion in terms of the championship position. But Ocon down the inside, looks like the AlphaTauri is kind of doing what the opposite of what they did last episode, and looks like they're losing race pace here at Sao Paulo rather than gaining it as they did at Mexico. As Verstappen now, I think he's side by side with Ocon. These two at Sao Paulo is always a very tasty thing, of course, and a bit awkward, and Ocon on the outside, DRS open, and the Frenchman is flying past in that McLaren. Behind you can see Norris. Will he go for the move? No, he won't. He's a little bit cautious, of course. You know, he doesn't need to send his nose in there. You know, he needs to, you know, just be patient and not get caught up in anything. So he doesn't take any risks there to be expected. And so he sticks behind. Meanwhile, back to our race. And we've now got Carlos Sainz for company. He is absolutely flying. He is a man on a mission. Fast up the Grand Prix, taken away from myself, that is. And Sainz on the inside. We try and defend, squeeze him to the left. All rubbing tyres on the left-hand side. We're a little bit off the racing line, though. on the left-hander. We get back in the slipstream, though. We're going to pull to the left-hand side tire on the grass. It's so close to Sainz on the side pod. We're trying our hardest to maintain the P3, but the Red Bull has the overwhelming pace there down the crest before we climb the hill once again in Sector 2, and Sainz is passed up into P3. It's still Gasly, by the way, leading the way from Leclerc. Bit of a gap then to this fight between myself and Sainz, and then behind you can still see there in the background is a checkerboard of AlphaTauri and McLaren, but Sainz is through. He's got the pace in the corners, but I will say I'm able to keep up with him on the straights in the last sector and into the first. So you can see, actually, I've ironically set my personal best lap time being behind him on lap 11, and we continue to use him as a bit of a horse to my carriage, basically, and using that kind of advantage we get with the DRS to kind of save some fuel, use DRS and close up, and we're actually keeping up pace with him. And the thing is, he's catching Leclerc and Gasly, so I'm effectively catching those two. So we're using the Red Bull to good effect. Leclerc is in for an earlier pit stop and a team radio.
Some information on Leclerc. They have some kind of mechanical problem.
So the Ferrari has issues. So this just got very interesting. That is going to be music to Sainz's ear, but that's great for me as well. So Leclerc's pit a lap earlier than all of us, and now he's got issues with his car. He's going to be limping around like Gasly did, remember, at the Japanese Grand Prix. So he's going to be very slow. Gasly comes in, so I can't come in on this lap. I don't want to double stack, of course. So we continue on for one more lap. So we're going to go 15 laps of these soft tyres, you know, so they are very, very second-hand, but somehow, with the DRS, that's the power of the DRS, I've been able to stick in the DRS of Sainz, and I'm actually still within 1 second of him, despite being on the softer compound tyre. I've gone as long as he has on a set of softs, and we're both coming in for a set of hard tyres, so that's probably one of the craziest stints I've done in terms of the first stint in the race, because usually I face a lot of tyre wear compared to AI in the first stint on heavier fuel, but we've done a madness there. And so we're going to come out, still behind Sainz, but on the right-hand side, you may have seen that was Gasly coming through. But there's Leclerc on the left, the red car, the Ferrari. He's limping. And so the order at the moment is Pierre Gasly still in first place. Then Sainz now, though, up into second place. And myself in third. Leclerc down to P4 now with an issue. And he may go down further down the road if those issues aren't solved. But Sainz is immediately on the back of Gasly. And he's through only one lap later. And Sainz is now in the lead of the Brazilian Grand Prix. So he has really been a man on the mission. Started P10, lap 17, and he's in P1 now. He has cut through everyone like a hot knife through butter, and that is the maximum his team can ask him to do for the driver's title here in P1. Meanwhile, Lando Norris, at the moment on the road, is in P8. He's behind the likes of Ricciardo, Albon, but those two are maybe going to pit again, and I don't know what the gap is really from Norris to those guys, but as it stands, Norris on the road is P8. He's been very slow on these medium tyres. He's moved over to the hard, of course, as everyone has made that first and only pit stop of the Grand Prix, but he's P8 in the road. So that would only be, you know, that's only 4 points. So at the moment, Sainz would gain 21, and that would be enough to seal the titles. We make a very bold move on Pierre Gasly on lap 18. It was so close on the left-hand side. On my front left to his front right, but we've made it and we're up into P2. I'm going to try and see if I can do anything to chase after Sainz. I don't care about the championship fight. This is for me personally. Obviously, we are yet to get a race win this season, so I want to try and see if we can make this a season where we don't go winless, but it's going to be tough. That Red Bull looks so quick, as is shown there by Ricciardo getting past Leclerc, but Leclerc obviously is limping still at the moment. But Albon, I think his pit, that Racing Points pit from those soft tyres. So Norris gains one position there up into P7, and then on the very next lap, Ricciardo comes in having made an earlier pit stop, and so that second Red Bull's not really helping out the kind of first one in first place, as that will place Norris surely then up into P6, as at the moment it's Sainz, myself, Gasly, Leclerc in P4, Ocon closing up rapidly though, as that Ferrari's still got an issue on its car. So Lando Norris is in P6 then on the road, but I think that actually is still not good enough. He needs to gain one more position to be safe here, because Sainz in first place and with the fast lap of the Grand Prix would gain 26 points. In sixth place, you get 8 points, so that would put them level. That would be a gain of 18 points for the Spaniards. And if they're level on points, I'm pretty sure the championship would be decided by race wins. and Sainz has got way more. I think he's got like a good 3 more race wins than Norris. So I think he actually needs to get one more position. So overtaking that slow Ferrari, they're going to have to hope Leclerc's issue does not get fixed before they get past him. Ocon's going to have to overtake him, maybe hopefully hold him up or something like that. But Norris needs to get one more position to be safe, because otherwise he's banking on someone else stealing the fast lap of the Grand Prix from Sainz. And so here he goes down the inside. Ocon's already passed, and that's a crucial die for Norris there. So aggressive. You never know with it, you know, in any of these corners, there could be contact. We've seen so many times the Mercedes cars have got caught up with dive bombs and whatnot, but Norris had to make that move. So now it really is sealed, surely. Sainz is looking likely to win it. He actually doesn't have the fast lap of the Grand Prix anymore, actually. So actually, P6 would be good enough, but Norris is even better. He's up into P5, but even if Sainz did somehow find some time, basically, later on in this race to get the fast lap of the Grand Prix, Norris in P5, that is enough for him to win the championship. But the McLarens, they're hotting up. They looked very weirdly slow at the start of this Grand Prix, which was very odd to me, to be honest. And now they're looking a little bit more pacey, like they have done this season. And both Ocon and Norris are closing up to myself and Gasly. So the fight may not be over for myself and Gasly to make this a double podium at the moment in a great position, P2 and 3. I'm unable to close up to Sainz. He's waltzed away. He's a good few seconds down the road. And now it's all about looking behind us and trying to maintain this. But Gasly is also attacking me, as well as the McLarens coming at us. Gasly on the inside. We're deploying ERS all the way down that straight, but he's still got the straight line speed advantage with DRS. We're able to maintain P2 and trap position for now. But on the exit of the center S, Gasly has a very good run. We're deploying some more ERS in the background. Gasly goes defensive. Ocon to the middle. It's almost 3 wide. Norris on the outside. That might be quite dangerous. Gasly back on the inside of us. And Norris and Ocon are pretty much nose to tail there. And Ocon keeps on fighting down the hill, up the hill now in sector 2. And Ocon's passed. He's on the inside. And Norris gets his nose in, maybe. But Ocon is through up into P3. Can Gasly fight it down the crest, the left hander? The two wheel to wheel, the two fellow countrymen. Ocon, though, gets the P3. So as it stands now, it's Sainz in the commanding lead. Myself still just about in second place, but Ocon is now P3. Gasly down to P4. Norris still behind in P5. But these two McLarens looking like they want to attack us and steal this double podium. They want to finish off with a double podium, because maybe, I don't know what the maths is, that a double podium might be enough to try and challenge for the championship and the constructors maybe versus Red Bull. So I don't know if that's the motive here, but Norris going around the outside, he's actually playing a very dangerous game here, and he's on the inside of the second part of the center S, the long way round, and Gasly, Norris trying to battle for P4, and meanwhile Ocon down the inside with DRS. We're deploying ERS, trying to defend on the outside. He's on the inside line. Yellow flags. Oh, Ocon! Oh no! Oh, Norris and Ocon have made contact! What's going on there?
Back!
Keep going for now.
I can't, it's broken! It's broken!
It is indeed broken. Lando Norris's front wing is broken. He's broken it on his teammate's rear end. What on earth went on there? Now my rear end stepped out. I think Ocon made contact with my rear end. And I think his suspension broke off of something here. With obviously simulation damage on this career mode. We've seen sometimes it's been very sensitive. Alan, Mercedes cars and auto. Remember Verstappen at Bahrain had a very sensitive suspension arm in the second race of this season, all those races ago. And it's seems like a similar sort of situation. Like, it just maybe looked like the perfect angle, the pinpoint perfect angle, and Ocon's front tire snapped on the rear. It was a very weird accident, because I didn't feel anything on the rear end of it. I looked behind me and it looked like an engine failure from Ocon at first, but I think it was a suspension failure in the end. But the McLarens have come to war, and Ocon may have just gifted Sainz the championship. It's Sainz, and Norris is in. Norris is in. McLaren decided to come in and not make Norris limp around. He was ahead of Leclerc still. He was still in P5. He could have limped around. There was only 2 laps to go in this race. McLaren, why have you come in? If that was me, I would have just tried to firm it and just stay out with that broken front wing, because there was only 2 laps to go. And now Carlos Sainz has won the Grand Prix. He set the fast lap of the Grand Prix for good good measure as well to really double down and get that extra point in the championship. But it doesn't matter. Norris is way down the order. And so here in the last dying stages of the Brazilian Grand Prix, drama has ensued and Carlos Sainz has pulled off a miracle to win his first world championship for Red Bull.
Yes. Vamos, 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 vamos. Toma, toma. Toma.
I cannot believe it. As simple as that. Wow. What a drive. Thank you, guys. Perfect execution. Good risk reward. Amazing. Amazing. What do you think? Do you think that was a smooth operator?
It's certainly been an incredible year for Formula One, and our drivers have all pushed themselves this season, making it one of the most compelling years of racing in history. There can only be one champion, however, and here they are now, our new Formula One World Drivers Champion. Victory today then, but bittersweet emotions, I'm sure, as the championship slips through their fingers. Even so, what a fantastic final race of the season this was. Anthony Davidson, a resounding victory today. What set them apart from the rest?
I'd say it was down once again to good, consistent driving, nailing the corners, working to the track conditions, and perfecting the team's strategies. They got all of these things right today, and the results speak for themselves.
Take a bow. Carlos Sainz has won the F1 World Championship. He is the world champion here in season 4 of our F1 2020 My Team Career Mode, and he's done it against all the odds. He's taken an 18-point deficit and turned it around and won the championship by 5 points, with Norris imploding there with McLaren, his own teammate, the one giving him damage on the front wing. My word, absolutely bonkers. What a finale at the Brazilian Grand Prix. That was insane. Absolutely insane. What a way to win your first world championship there. And it's one of our old teammates from season 2. Sainz came to our team as a race winner. He, remember, won one race with McLaren at the end of season 1 at Abu Dhabi, I think it was. So he came to our team as a race winner. He won a few races with us. You know, he didn't quite have the consistency we wanted it to in our team. Then went to Red Bull. Had a bit of an unlucky time in season 3. But here he is, season 4, winning multiple races in a row in the middle of that thing. Not being as consistent as Lando Norris, I actually admit, but in the end, he's persevered. It was a stonking drive, remember, from P10 to P1 in half the race distance, and then just controlled it from there. I mean, GGs, but commiserations, such big commiserations for Lando Norris. That is unreal. Such a tragic way to lose a championship, breaking your front wing on the rear end of your teammate. And then I think personally McLaren made a mistake there. They should have let him stay out and just limped home to try and still get, I think, P5 or 6 to give him half a chance. But in the end, he finishes down in P10 and only gets 1 or 2 championship points, actually, because he stole the fast lap away then from Sainz at the end of that thing. But my word, what an ending to the championship. And for us as a team, personally, we got a 2-3, so we did it. We ended off the season with a double podium for the team, our first double podium, this season, so that's great. And also, we personally equaled our best result, P2, all the way, race number 2 of this season in the Bahrain Grand Prix. It's taken us 15 races to equal that position of P2, but we've done it, and we finally found some confidence again with the car after having a bit of a shaky time once Gasly won that race at Singapore. But mental end to season 4, and now the dust settles and we look on to season 5 potentially. I'll say this now ahead of the pre-season. I'm very much considering signing Gasly again. You know, he's obviously done a massive job to advertise himself in the shop window and is given himself, you know, pretty much ticked every box in terms of he's a race winner now. He's won in our car. He's the only winner in our car this season. This is a winless season. The first time I've not won since season 1. So that's a bit of a, you know, a bit of a reality check maybe for us. Next season, we need to kind of pick up our pace a bit. And it's going to be difficult because Gasly has looked so strong on every Saturday. And on Sunday, yes, we've got the best measure of him in the last two episodes, but he's generally looked a lot better in the second half of this season. So I think if we are to be in a championship fight next season with this car, I think Gasly is going to be a massive force to contend with. But I am thinking of re-signing him because, you know, forgetting about all the history with Gasly's AI in the past with us on the F1 game, on this game, he's been a great teammate. And honestly, he's actually pushed me to try and push harder because he's been so rapid, especially on the Saturdays. But there is an important vote to do. Obviously, we went bankrupt at the start of this season. We've now got a lot of our claim back. And so going into next season, it is time to return to some big sponsorship for the car. And so you guys get to vote on what our main big top sponsor is going to be on the side pods, the halo, and kind of all generally all over the car. So vote with the straw poll link in the description and the comments below for that. But till then, guys, for pre-season of Season 5, hope you guys enjoy not only this episode, but the entirety of Season 4, a very different season, starting off bankrupt, a shortened calendar, short and sweet, a lot of action. I think you'll admit at the end here, a lot of drama to round out the championship. But Carlos Sainz is your brand new F1 world champion. If you did enjoy it, smash the like button. Let me know what you thought in the comments below. If you're on your around here, then do get subscribed for weekly Formula 1 content. Till Season 5, till then, goodbye.